And good morning, everyone. Good to be back. Thank you. That's what I'm fishing for. Yes, that's right. No. No, it's good to be back to finally get some rest from my vacation time. So it was good. It was a good time was had by all. We're going to be doing something hopefully a little different and hopefully a little better next week. Obviously, the restrictions are being relaxed, I think is the word, tomorrow. And so the session is going to meet at 7:30 this Tuesday to approve some recommendations from our COVID group that we be allowed to sit a bit closer together. Thank goodness for that. And to be able to sing. Now, before you get too excited, we'll be singing behind our masks, so it's not quite as freeing as we might like, but at least it's a step forward, and hopefully we will not take a step back again. Friends, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Hear these words, O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praises. The Lord's unfailing love and mercy never cease, fresh as the morning and sure as the sunrise. And these words from Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, and who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. And will you join me in prayer? Blessed are you, sovereign God, creator of all. To you be glory and praise forever. You founded the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. In the fullness of time, you made us in your image. And in these last days, you have sent to us your Son, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. As we rejoice in the gift of your presence among us, let the light of your love always shine in our hearts. Your Spirit ever renew our lives, and your praises ever be on our lips. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. And would you like to stand for the singing of hymn number 212? Eddie and Joyce will be leading us again.
Good morning. Our first reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17 to 25. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating, for I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruits. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain. Our second reading is from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, and may God bless this holy reading.
Well, since you all enjoyed the preaching through the book of Jonah so much, I'm going to start at the beginning again and work my way. No, you're all Jonah experts now, so I expect you'll be sharing all that good news with your friend. No, I'm going to be moving on to the book of Ephesians and having a look at some of the writings of Paul. Paul is obviously a huge figure in the New Testament, having been responsible for writing a good portion of it. So it's important that we have an understanding of his way of thinking and the message that he brought. And this letter to the Ephesians is the beginning of what I hope will be an illuminating and enlightening series of sermons for you. But before we begin, let's start with a word of prayer. O God of light, we pray that you would illuminate our hearts, fire our imagination, and embolden us to go forth into the world with this message of profound good news. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen. What do we say? The first thing, when we see someone in the morning, say, good morning. Morning. I was walking up the street this morning and kind of head down thinking about things, and I heard this voice say, morning. And I looked up, and there's a lady walking her dog. And it was just an encouragement. I didn't know who she was, but she said, morning. And then on the way a little farther up the road, I saw a friend. Good morning, good morning. Good to see you, good to see you. And then, of course, the chance to see everyone else here this morning. Good morning. Why do we say that? Or good day, or good evening, or have a nice day. Or as they say in Texas, y'all come back now, have a blessed day. Why do we say these things? Are they just throwaway phrases? Or is there something more that lies behind them? I think there's something very significant about those little greetings. And it's more than just a statement of fact. It may be a good morning, maybe sunny and bright, or it may be rainy, which obviously we need a bit of rain here. What makes for a good morning? Does a good morning mean that you wake up feeling strong and vigorous? Or does a good morning mean that you enjoyed a fry-up? and get to wear a new pair of shoes. No, it's even more than that. By saying good morning to one another, you're wishing someone well. You're wishing goodness upon them. You're effectively casting a vision and inviting them to share in a picture of life that is better than it would be without that salutation. When you say good morning, you're saying, isn't it good to be alive? When you say good morning, you're saying, I hope your day is good. And what do we mean? I hope your day is filled with wholeness and holiness. I hope this day will be a day of human flourishing for you. I hope this day will bring an engagement with your loved ones. I hope this day will brighten you with the presence of strangers. I hope this day will bring good news. You see, it's painting a picture of goodness that you're wishing someone to enjoy and to enjoin with you. It's effectively a prayer. It's like an arrow of blessing that you're firing into someone's heart. And it's that same thing that Paul is doing at the beginning of this letter when he says, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you. It's like good morning multiplied 1,000 times. It's like good morning with 1,000 watts of power. And the difference is that it's not a wish. It's not a wish upon a falling star. It's not a, gosh, I hope things go well for you. When he says grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, he's saying, I invite you into a vision of the kingdom, a kingdom that's characterized by wholeness. The Jews and the Muslims have a word they say, shalom. And the Muslims say salam, which is the same word in different languages. And that word means peace. It means fullness of life. It means I pray that God will lift you from whatever agonies you are bearing today. I wish you God's peace and wholeness. And this is what Paul is doing in this first letter. It's not just a throwaway phrase at the beginning. He's saying, I've got some good news because I've climbed the mountain and I've seen a vision of what is to come. And not only what is to come, but what is already here in what God has done through the person of Jesus. Some of you will know that I spent some time backpacking with the kids at the beginning of July in Skye. And we saw some amazing sights, to say the least. And if you've never been to Skye, I can highly commend it. And I think we saw some places that only a very small portion of the population of Scotland has seen it. They're unspoiled wildernesses out there. And we took a chance. We had a day, and we said, well, let's climb a hill. So we did. And if you've ever climbed a hill, you'll know that awe-inspiring moment when you turn around from the trudge of step, 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 climbing, and you look around and you see where you've come. And all of a sudden, a whole new vista opens up, not just in your eyes, but also in your heart. Also in your heart. Because there's a great sense that the world is greater than I imagined, greater than I was aware. And one of the boys who came with me, we got to the very top, and we looked down, and we could see our tents in the distance. They were just pinpricks of light way in the distance. But what we did see was we saw the hills, not only on Skye, but the islands, and we saw what I'm sure was the mainland way off to the east. And we also saw a larger perspective of where we were from our campsite. And we saw something we hadn't seen before, and that was that we were strategically located between the sea and a freshwater loch. And this sea looked like the Caribbean. The waters were blue and the sand at the edge of the sea, and there was a three-masted sailing ship in the harbor and all kinds of smaller boats dotted around. It could have been taken in Jamaica. And so we said, when we get down from this hill, we're going to swim first in the sea, and then we're going to rinse off in the freshwater loch. And we did. And it's magnificent. And I can assure you, the water was a lot colder there than it would have been in Jamaica. And if there was any confusion in our mind about whether we were in Jamaica or Scotland, that was clarified in a heartbeat. Very cold water, but beautiful. But what climbing that hill did was we were able to go down to our fellows and said, hey, do you realize we're so close to the loch and to the sea? And so, of course, they did the same. They swam in the sea and then in the loch. And this is what Paul is saying when he says, grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. He's saying, I have seen a vision of something that is greater, something for which we have a down payment right now, something that is magnificent beyond words. Paul had a vision in another letter. He talks about he was transported into the heavenly places, and he saw things that no mortal being can describe, the same sorts of things that Isaiah saw at the beginning of his book, his words from God. Transported into the heavenly realms, things that are beyond description. And this is what Paul is saying. This is, we have a down payment. We have the first installment on what is coming. And he was saying these things because he said, don't get distracted by what's right in front of you. Don't get obsessed with satisfying your immediate needs, because there's something better that's coming. Don't settle for less. And he was saying that because in Ephesus, the church that to whom he was writing this letter, there was a very famous temple called the Temple of Artemis. Now, Artemis was a female goddess whom some scholars believe fell first as a meteorite. So a magnificent, bizarre thing. You should see, look up images of Artemis on Google when you get home, a bizarre image. And she was worshipped as the goddess of fertility and the goddess of safe births and deliveries. And she was inside this temple that was literally one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. It was like the Acropolis, a multi-columned thing, hundreds of columns. And it was about 150 meters long and about 50 meters wide. So about 1.5 football fields in length and the similar in breadth. It was an enormous thing. And also a major tourist attraction. Pilgrims came from all over. And as you'd expect, in any tourist attraction town, there were craftsmen who made little images of Artemis that you could take home. Or ones you could carry in your purse or your pocket. And they made their living, silversmiths. And Artemis was worshipped and adored, and Paul came in with a very controversial message and said, this is not good news, this is fake news. The Artemis, she's nothing. She's a lump of metal. She's a false god. And when you try to worship Artemis, you're just talking to yourself. She's just a piece of rock overlaid with gold. Nothing more. There is no power in Artemis. Going to see Artemis is like going to worship yourself. And don't be deceived into thinking that she's anything more. That this grand temple, it's just stone. It's beautiful, yeah, it's great. But there's nothing to it. It just goes to make you feel good right now. But I've had a vision of something greater, and I've been sent to tell you. He says, Paul, I am an apostle of Jesus Christ, called by God. An apostle means someone who is sent to bear a message. He was a messenger from God. That was his task in life. This was sort of like his seal of authenticity. It was his credentials. I'm an apostle. Which doesn't say anything great about me. It says something about the one who sent me. The one who sent me is from above, the living God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who brings genuine grace and peace to you, your Savior, the one who forgives your sins, the one who, as I said a moment ago, who heals all your diseases and forgives all your iniquities, the God who brings shalom, the God who brings peace and wholeness. This is what God is bringing us. And in the rest of this letter, he talks more about, one, what that looks like, and two, how it's happened, about what God has done. And he calls people the saints. Saints. Why does he call them that? Not because they're righteous in their own power, but because God has made them righteous. And guess what, friends? You're saints. I know in Scotland, you're told to keep your head down and your mouth shut, right? Because you're no good. That message is beaten into us. But Paul is saying that too is fake news. There's something greater here, that you are saints because God has redeemed you. God has forgiven you. He's healed all your diseases and forgiven all your sins and made things well. And we have a down payment of that. It's not complete yet, but it's like the first installment of an inheritance that will be ours in God's time in the future. And the future that Paul is talking about is the same one that Isaiah was talking about. I'm just going to read just a few words of what that looks like. And again, bear in mind that Isaiah had this vision, this indescribable vision of heaven. And so what we're reading about is metaphors. Some of the things may actually happen literally, but it's metaphoric. It's a way of envisioning something that can't be envisioned. He says, "For I, God says, am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I'm creating. A new heaven and a new earth." Now, wouldn't that be grand? Wouldn't that be grand? This is what scholars talk about as eschatology, which is the study of the end times. In other words, where are we going? Life is not just about plodding up an endless hill. Life is about pausing to look back on where you've come and to embrace that expansive vision about where we're going. About where we're going. And again, Paul's admonition is that we should run towards that vision like an athlete in the Olympics. Have you been watching the Olympics? Yeah, bits and pieces. I think the Olympics are hilarious because we all become suddenly passionate about sporting events we've never heard about before. And we're cheering for people we've never met before and probably will never meet again. But there's something magical about the Olympics. And when I think about those few moments, those few minutes, often those few seconds that separate the silver and the gold and the bronze and then all the also-rans, I think about the hours, the days, the years that these young people have put into their sport. And that's the image that Paul is using to commend the pursuit of this new heaven and new earth to you and me. Don't give up. Remember the prize. Remember the vision. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Remember the vision of the new heaven and the new earth that God is creating and has already begun to create right here and right now. We have lots of Artemises in this life. Promises of short-term gain. And they always disappoint. Do you ever look at stuff online and you think, oh, that's for me. That's going to be the thing that will fix this problem, that will fill this gap in my life. And almost invariably, it's like Amazon should have a little disclaimer at the bottom that says, all of these things come with buyer's remorse. Be forewarned. No matter how glitzy and wonderful it looks on screen, when you get it, you're always going to be disappointed. And that's the thing about the Artemises of this world. They promise what they can't deliver. They promise grace and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. But it's just stone and gold and lumps of wood that have no power whatsoever. God is doing a new thing. God is doing a new thing right here in the church and in our community. And over the last 18 months, this pandemic has just hastened a process that had been undergoing for some time. People say, well, John, where's the church going? I say, well, I don't know, but I think this is a grand opportunity for us to try some new things and to listen for the leading of the Spirit in ways that we had not expected before. So I want to invite you on a journey. I want to invite you to begin to pray with me as we take those steps, plod, 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 up the hill to remind ourselves and refresh our imagination about what God has in store for us. That we should leave all the Artemises of this life behind us and we should carry on up the holy mountain to see what God has for us. There's some exciting things in store, but they're scary things. Because in order to get there, you have to leave behind some of the things that you once thought were important. You have to leave them behind. So what are you prepared to leave behind? Who or what is the Artemis in your life? What are you hanging on to that you think, I've got to have this as I go up the mountain? Because I can tell you one thing for sure, as someone who's done some backpacking, is that the more stuff you carry, the slower you go, and the harder and more discouraging is the journey. Good morning. And may the grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Amen. And will you stand as we listen to the hymn number 238?
In harmony. Creation groans, travails, futile its present flight. Bound till the hour it hails God's children born of light, that we may gain our true estate. Come, Lord, new heavens and earth create.
Just a reminder, this is the period, the point in time where we usually respond to God's grace by giving of ourselves in the form of our financial gifts. Obviously, we're still not doing that by the old manner, but if you'd like to make a gift, you can do so at the door as you go out today. Or you can do so online by looking at our website. We have a PayPal link at kadzochurch.org.uk. So have a look at our homepage and you'll see a link that you can make a gift virtually, a real gift done in a virtual manner. Now, though, I want to invite you to join me in a word of prayer. So let us pray. And I want to invite you to join me responding in this prayer by saying, Lord, have mercy, as I pause after each second. So in peace, let us pray to the Lord, and Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the unity of the Church of God, and for the well-being of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this gathering of the faithful, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all the baptized, for all who serve in the church, for presbyters and chief executives and ministers and lay people and elders and deacons, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our prime minister and for our first minister, for the leaders of the nations and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this town, for the town of Hamilton, for the Shire of Lanarkshire, for central Scotland, for all of Scotland, Britain, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For seasonable weather and for abundant harvests for all to share, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and the will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who travel by land and water or air or even into outer space, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the aged and infirm, for the widow and the orphaned, for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor and the oppressed, for those unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For deliverance in times of affliction, strife, and need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who have lost loved ones, for the family of Alistair Porter, and those who grieve, whose names we carry upon our hearts, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For your church and for the world, which is beset on every corner by droughts and floods and heat waves tsunamis and mudslides and every conceivable catastrophe, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, you've given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common prayers to you. And you've promised through your beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth and in the age to come, life everlasting. And we offer these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And our closing hymn, number 642. Eternal God, our beginning and our end, be our starting point and our haven, and accompany us in this day's journey. Use our hands to do the work of your creation, and use our lives to bring others the new life that you give in Jesus Christ, Redeemer of all. And now, friends, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.